So Jesus said, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Wouldn't that be good if that could be said of each one of us? I know I would like it. I would appreciate it if that were said of me, not because I want the accolades, but because that's the way that I was, you know. This is something that we should all aspire to be like, is to be full of faith and have great faith. And the word great here is not necessarily meaning fantastic. It means large. That's what it translates out to, large faith. Turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1, verse 8. And here we see Paul addressing the Romans, telling them something about their faith. And he says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. Isn't that amazing? Their faith was spoken about through the whole world. So they must have had great faith. And isn't it interesting that the person who Jesus said had great faith, so much so that no one else in Israel had that, was a Roman? Is there something about Romans that they have greater faith? I don't know. Well, one of the things that characterize great faith is great love, right? Because if you have love, great love for God, you will do what he says. You will do the great things, the large things, the small things, anything that he will ask you. Here's some more that had great faith. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15 to 17. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Now, the result here in verse 17 is meant to increase the faith so that when we have a revelation in the knowledge of him and we have the spirit of wisdom, we'll have greater faith and we'll end up having that, what the Bible calls faith, from faith to faith as it grows. And it's like a cycle, it's a positive cycle that goes upward. The more faith you exercise, the more faith that you have. The more doubt that you have, the more doubt you will get. It's a downward cycle. Another one, Colossians 1, 3 to 5. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of truth, of the truth of the gospel. The Colossians had great faith. One more. These Thessalonians, well, let's just read what it says. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to Godward is spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. They had such great faith that it was known everywhere. They were going abroad. They were sharing their faith. People knew the Thessalonians as people who had great faith, so much so that Paul said, if I go to a different place from where you're at, I don't have to tell them about your great faith. They already heard of it. Wouldn't that be nice if that were said of us, that we have great faith? The people here of Advent Hope have great faith. Well, in contrast to that, we have the Jewish spiritual leaders of the day of Jesus, who for the most part were not known for their faith. What were they known for? Their rigidity to keeping the laws and traditions of the fathers. Their desire to appear holy by the things that they said, their desire to be looked at as, wow, look at that man, isn't he holy? These are the things that they were known for. They were also known for their lack of compassion because of their rigidity to the laws of God and to some traditions, or most of their traditions. Greatness to them was the ability to command respect from the people because of what they said and how they appeared. This lack of faith was the model to which the common people were accustomed to. But they were quietly desiring something better, something greater. And we have an evidence of this, of how they were in the rebukes of Jesus to these spiritual leaders. Matthew chapter 23, starting at verse 25. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye may clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisee, clean first that which is within the cup and the platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like unto whited sepulchres, or coffins, or tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but within are full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Now take a minute to think about what he's saying here. When a body is decaying, that's not pleasant. It stinks and the sight is disgusting. That's what he's saying to them. You are like inside, but on the outside, you look wonderful. You paint yourself up to, or make yourself up to look really good so that people admire you, but inside you're corrupt. Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within you are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. No one wants to be like that. I don't want to be known for being like that. But if we're not known for our great faith, is it possible that people can perceive us to be like that? This concern, if we take it, can cause some of us to go in the other direction, being like the Jewish leaders, trying to be perceived as loving, full of faith, but really slack when it comes to living a godly life. In other words, we become really nice. We become people pleasers, but we're afraid to speak the truth. We do not want that either. There's something that stands out in Jesus' rebuke that I believe we can learn from. Two words. One is a title and the other is an action. Can you spot them up there? One is a title, something that he named them, and the other one is an action. Right, hypocrites and hypocrisy. We must not allow ourselves to become hypocrites, but rather be genuine, loving people who are empowered by a love that is not common in this world. Well, the disciples of Jesus had minds that were molded by their culture, their religion, the traditions of the men of their religion, their natural thoughts of what God was like. So they revealed this in trying times. That's what we all do. We reveal who we are and what we're like when times get difficult, when there's a lot of pressure and we don't have time to make decisions or think things through. And I want to look at this. If you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8, starting at verse 23. And when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he said unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? And Jesus showed that he came when the fullness of time was come. He revealed, or they saw and heard of, his Father anointing him with the Holy Spirit as a dove coming down upon him. He had done some miraculous things that they had witnessed. He had spoken some things that they had never heard before. They had experienced personally the love of God in Jesus. How could they think that he would allow that ship to sink with them on it? How could they think, that he would just allow his ministry to just end like that? Then Jesus got up and commanded the wind and the sea to be still. Can you imagine what was going through their minds? They said, What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? They had never seen anything like that before, ever. And this just brought a fear, an awe over them. Who is this? Who can do this? And rather than being inspired by Jesus' love for them and care for them, they got stuck in the act of what he did. But you can see that by what they said. But Jesus' question seems kind of strange when you think about it. How is it that you had no fear, no faith? Why is it that you're so fearful? I mean, wouldn't we be in that situation? Wouldn't we be afraid and lacking faith? I mean, but there's something that we're lacking. If Jesus had to ask that question, there was something lacking that they needed to have. He must have done something or said something that they understood that would have made it plain that if a situation like that were ever to arise, that they just needed to call upon him and they would be okay. They would be safe. They would be saved. So the thought comes to my mind that they must have missed something in order for Jesus to say that. They were impressed by all the miracles, but did not allow their hearts to receive what God was giving them. Their minds were directed to the possibility of gain. They were associated with this miracle worker who wanted them to be with him. And I can imagine him now, wow, he wants us to be with him. This is awesome. Look at the things that he's doing. We can't wait till he sets up his kingdom. This is going to be something else. You know, just like someone just dying to win a lottery, you know, planning what they're going to do with the money when they win, right? This is what their mind is like, rather than looking at him and loving him and understanding what he was doing for them. They were looking at him as a reason for gain. And so their faith was not there. It was just not there. Let's look at biblical faith for a minute. Turn to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. We want to have a definition, a biblical definition, so we can set our sights on the right kind of faith. Hebrews 11, verse 1. We're all familiar with this. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now we'll get into what that means a little bit further on, but this is a definition of faith. And as we mentioned in our Sabbath school class, But without this type of faith, it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Without this faith, anything that we do will not be pleasing to God. The question that may come to some is, why? Because faith is an expression of true love for God. How do we get this faith? Well, the answer is written in the verse. This is kind of exactly like what we read about in Sabbath school. Believe that he is, meaning express that he exists in word and action, and know that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, which brings us true happiness. To believe that God exists is a choice that we must all make. It is our first step. The other component in getting faith is to be permanently convicted that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. The reward is that the Holy Spirit will show us clearly, or clear imagery of what Jesus Christ is like and what the Father is like, so much so that they will come to us and live in us. And we have that in John chapter 14, verse 23. If a man love me, how do you express when you love somebody? How do you express your love to somebody? You search after them. You want to be with them. You want to do the things that they do. You want to do the things that they say. If any man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode, or our habitation, our place to live with him. Now that is amazing, that the God of the universe is going to come and dwell with us. That is the reward when we diligently seek him. We must believe that he is, and a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, and that's going to be it. What else could you ask for? No wonder he says, be content with such things as you have. You've got God, the God of the universe, dwelling in you. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. So when we have them dwelling within us, we can safely say that we have eternal life. We cannot and should not boastfully say, I'm saved forever and I'm never going to be lost, because we all have choices. But we can know by his word, because that's where we place our faith, in his word, not in our feeling, not in anything within us, but in his word. If we know them and what they're like and love them, then we'll have the truth and we'll have eternal life. So if the truth about God leads to eternal life, then lies about them must lead to death, which is exactly what happened in the beginning. When Eve was deceived and believed a lie, death followed. Faith and truth are in a war against doubt and lies. So faith comes by truth, and truth is found in the Word of God. All right, and here we go. John 14:6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Listen to what he's saying here. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. Next verse. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Next one. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. John 3:17. The last one. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You see the connection? We've got to have the word of God to get the truth, and as we get the truth, we have eternal life. That's the connection. That's how we receive eternal life, and that's how our faith is strengthened and built by the word of God. So how do we know that this is all true? Well, because sin leads to death, and lies were the vehicle to bring sin into the world. So if Jesus lied, he would not have been resurrected. And if he was not resurrected, then we could have no faith in God. Who would we have faith in? How could we have faith if Jesus were not resurrected and alive in heaven? Our faith would be foolishness and useless. But God has not left us without certainty. John, 1 John 4, 12 and 13. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. So we need to have that confidence, right? The confidence is his Spirit dwelling in us. Now, if his Spirit dwells in us, what are we going to be like? What's going to happen to us? How do we determine that the Holy Spirit is within us? Right? The fruit of the Spirit, a change in character, those things that we used to love, we no longer love. The things that we used to hate, we now love. The wickedness that we could excuse, we no longer want to excuse. We see how great sin is, and we avoid it. We want to do what God asks us to do. We want to take care of the spirit of the temple that his Spirit dwells in. We want to live for God. This is how we know if his Spirit is in us. Now I want to go back to Hebrews 11:1 just to talk about it. But you remember the woman that had the issue of blood? Right? That's in Mark. You can turn there. Mark 5, and we're going to read through these verses, and we're going to look at her faith. Mark 5, verses 30 to 34. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press, or in the people, the crowd, and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said unto him, "Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" There's thousands of people around Jesus bumping into him. And they're like, "Lord, how can you say these things? I mean, look at all the people around you. How can you say, who touched me? I mean, a lot of people touched you. What are you saying?" And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." So here's what goes on. This is a definition, an explanation of godly faith. You see Jesus, you see the character of God, something happens within. Something is born within, and you desire to go to him, toward him. You must go. Something is drawing you to him, to believe that what he said is truth and will be accomplished. You move towards that without any doubt, and you reach out and you touch him. Touching him means I accept him. I take him wholly as mine. And this is what she was doing, and this is what we must do. But this faith that she has here is not a human faith. This is the Spirit of God moving within her. This is what we would call the faith of Jesus. Another one, the centurion, whom Jesus said he had not seen so great faith, no, not in all Israel. To him, faith was seen in the same way. He had love in his heart, right? Why did he call for Jesus? Because his servant, whom he loved, was sick. It was going to die. So he calls for Jesus. And he says, Lord, you don't even have to come to my house. I fully understand the operation of faith. I understand the operation of command. I'm in command, and when I say something, people do what I say. And I know that when you say this, it's going to happen. I have no doubt whatsoever. Just say the word. And Jesus marveled and said, I have never seen a faith like this, not even in Israel, who should have had more faith than anyone. But they were stuck in forms and traditions and being the greatest. Another type of faith that is in the world, which is very dangerous and could lead to us being lost, is called presumption. Right? I'm going to give you two dictionary definitions here. The first one says, an idea that is taken to be true and often used as the basis for other ideas, although it is not known for certain. Right? So you get this idea in your mind, God wants me to do this thing, but it's not written in the Word. It's just something that you desire, you want, really, and you're presuming that it's okay. You don't have a certainty in the Word of God telling you that it's okay. The second one is behavior perceived as arrogant, disrespectful, and transgressing the limits of what is permitted or appropriate. I like that, because God has not told you. You're being arrogant toward God, and you're going beyond what God has said. We're presuming that it's just okay because I think so, based upon how we feel, what we think, rather than on God's word. That's dangerous, because we can be led to do things that will cause us to lose our salvation. And the one that comes to my mind is King Saul. He presumed to do things that he should have never done. He went on to offer a sacrifice. He never should have done that. Uzzah was the other one, who presumed to touch the ark of God. Should have never done that. Lost his life because of that. Lost his salvation. We cannot be presumptuous. Another one is superstition. Now, how does that fit in? Superstition fits in with faith, with false faith. When you think that you do a certain amount of things, therefore God is going to answer you. Right? So because I do this, this, and this, God has to do this, this, and this. That's really superstition. That's what that is. If I knock on the door, am I doing something, then I'm going to have good luck. My good luck is going to continue. If I do something, something good is going to happen in return. Superstition is a big part of false faith that people use in their religion. Here's a definition of it. A widely held but unjustified belief in supernatural causation leading to certain consequences of action or event, or a practice based on such a belief. And here it says, she touched her locket for luck, a superstition she had had since she was a child. So you could actually think of the woman who touched Jesus could have said to have had superstition. If I just touch his garment, I'll be healed. But that's not how she was looking at it, right? She was looking at him. It's him that is drawing me. He's the one that loves me. He's the one that's calling to my heart. I'm going to Him, to touch Him, to accept Him. And here's a verse that has been used presumptuously and in superstition. For I say unto you, let me read that off the paper here. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, I've often heard this, and you may have, this teaching that everybody has been given faith, that God has given to every man faith based on this verse. Well, we want to take a look at that. Well, I believe everybody can have faith. Everybody has the capacity to have faith, but not everybody has the faith of Jesus, which is the saving faith that we need. The example is often given, you've probably heard it, I see that chair, I have faith in the chair that if I go over and sit on it, it's going to hold me up and I won't fall down to the ground. That's not faith. That's a logical conclusion by what I see. You know, should I sit in that chair? It looks pretty good. Okay, I'm going to go and sit in it. We've reasoned things out. That's not what faith is. When we look back at the woman, her faith was born out of what Jesus was like. What she saw in Him is what created the faith in her. His response, the Bible says, He first loved us, and then we love in return, right? That's what she saw, that love coming to her, that virtue. So she responded to that. A chair cannot do that. You know, people cannot do that, not in the way that God does. So now we look at Hebrews 11:1 again. This woman sees Jesus, right? And she's hoping for something, but it's not based on any evidence that she can see. In other words, she looks at Jesus. There's nothing in this man that tells her that just by touching him, she's going to be healed. But there's something in him that's telling her that when she goes and touches him, she will be healed. But she can't see it. Right? It's not something you can see. It's a love that comes and it hits you and it goes through your soul and it affects you to the point where you have to move towards God. You're drawn to Him and you give yourself to Him. Faith is like gold tried in the fire. Jesus in Revelation 3 counsels the Laodiceans, that's our time period, to buy from him this gold that is tried in the fire. This is the faith of Jesus. If we are asked to buy it from him, how can we all possess it? He also will come into us and sup with him, and sup with us, and he with, I'm getting that confused now. That Jesus comes to us and he will sup with us and we with him. Meaning he will teach us how to eat. I mentioned that before. The health message is what he's teaching us. Just as he told his disciples to cast a net on the right side of the boat and they successfully caught many fish. So he tells us to live in a certain way, to live a health message in order to overcome the temptations of Satan. If we do, we can be victorious. So in other words, living the health message will be exercising faith and will be the same thing as buying gold tried in the fire. 2 Thessalonians 3:2 makes it pretty clear. It says, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men have not faith. So let's go back to Romans. Romans chapter 12 for a minute. And let's look at the context, and we'll see what exactly Paul is saying there. Romans chapter 12. Let's just start at verse 1, all right? I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Who is Paul talking to? The world or the Romans? The world or the Christians? The Christians. That's who he's addressing. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Who's he speaking to? Christians. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. What he's saying is to every man among you. He's not saying the whole world. So now we can see clearly this is not applying to everybody. Why is that important? Because if you think everybody has faith, then what's the reason, what point have you to go and talk to them? There's no real need. If they have faith, every man has faith, well, you know, it's not that important to go and talk to them. They'll find out sooner or later, you can think. But it's important to understand that people are out there are without faith. There are people out there that are without hope. There are people out there that are without love. They don't have the knowledge of God, and they're going to be destroyed at the return of Jesus. The brightness of his presence will destroy them. And so we must, if we love God, love them and go and tell them that no, they don't have faith. We may not say that, but we can tell them things that will inspire faith, which then will lead them to recognize, I don't have faith. And they'll pray, Lord, give me faith. Increase our faith. Faith is one of the characteristics that reveal that we are of the truth. The other characteristic is keeping the commandments of God. So there's two things. Paul says, this is the third time I am coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. So we got to have faith and keep the commandments of God. This is what distinguishes us as God's people. And this is what gives us our reason to go out into the world. And this gives us the ability to see and recognize who is not of God. Because if they don't have faith, and if they are not keeping the commandments of God, all 10 of them, then we know for sure that they need to hear the gospel. And we must, with the love of God in our hearts, share that with them. We want to have great faith, and it's there for us to take. But somehow we keep holding back. We don't fully give ourselves to God. We don't open up to God and say, take me fully right now. I'm going to do everything from this day forward. I don't care. I'm sold out. Very rare that we do that. If we do, it's for a time. Then we start feeling this and feeling that, and we start to draw back. Or we get caught up in the world. The Word of God is the foundation of our faith, and therefore it is by the Word of God that we may obtain evidence of our standing before God. We are not to make our feelings a test by which to discern whether we are in or out of favor with God, whether they be what we consider encouraging or not. As soon as one begins to contemplate his feelings, he is on dangerous ground. And that happens very frequently. Satan knows how to get to us. But we must exercise faith and not put any trust in our feelings. If he feels joyous, he is confident he is in a favorable condition. But when a change comes, as it will, for circumstances will be so arranged that feelings of depression will make the heart sad, then he will be naturally led to doubt that God has accepted him. It is not wisdom to look at the emotions and to try to test your spirituality by your feelings. Do not study yourself. Look away from self to Jesus. That is the key. It's so easy to do that. Why is this happening to me? How come this? How come me? Why not just turn away from self and look at the magnificent things that Jesus has done for us? He died on a cross. Now, as Christians, we say that so often that we kind of get cold to it. You know, we don't recognize how important that is. Jesus died on a cross for you and me. This must be the reality in our mind every day. When we get up in the morning, thank you, Lord, that I have life because you gave me yours. And therefore, that moment, from that moment on, we should be joyful. Waking up and getting out of bed, being miserable and angry and upset, should not be a part of a Christian's life. Now, there are circumstances when in sickness that you may not wake up feeling so great, but still, this is what we're being told. Don't look at how you feel. Don't look at anything. Look to Jesus. And as we look to Jesus, He will give us that security that we're looking for. He will give us that assurance that we're looking for. And how do we look to Jesus? Not only just looking in prayer and meditation, but look at His Word, the foundation of our faith. Let this point be fully settled in every mind. If we accept Christ as a redeemer, we must accept him as a ruler. We cannot have assurance and perfect confidence, confiding trust in Christ as our Savior until we acknowledge him as our King and are obedient to his commandments. Now think that through. All right, I'm gonna be his. I give myself completely to the Lord, but I'm not going to keep that commandment. I'm going to do something else instead. Because I really think, you know what? What did we just read? We cannot have assurance unless we keep all of his commandments. I mean, it's just natural. If you go around lying, how can you have peace and think that God is blessing you? If you go around stealing or shortchanging people, you know, cutting corners, how can you have peace? How can you know? How can you trust that God is pleased with you? You can't have that assurance. That's why God says, here's the patience of the saints. They can have faith because they have full confidence in him and they keep his commandments. And they have the faith of Jesus. Continuing on, thus we evidence our allegiance to God. We have then the genuine ring in our faith, for it is a working faith. It works by love. Speak it from your heart. Lord, I believe that thou hast died to redeem my soul. If thou hast placed such a value upon the soul as to give thy life for mine, I will respond. I give my life and all its possibilities in all my weakness into thy keeping. Did I do that? Sorry. All right. The will must be brought into complete harmony with the will of God. When this is done, no ray of light that shines into the heart and chambers of the mind will be resisted. The soul will not be barricaded with prejudice, calling light darkness and darkness light. That's presumption, right? The light from heaven is welcomed as light filling all the chambers of the soul. This is making melody to God. This is good. Satan cannot hold the dead in his grasp when the Son of God bids them live. He cannot hold in spiritual death one soul who in faith received Christ's word of power. No amens? We have had very few amens today. I guess we're kind of whatever. But anyway, think of that. Satan cannot hold in spiritual death one soul who in faith receives Christ's word of power. So when we receive Christ's word, we say, I'm responding. Satan has no power to hold us, none whatsoever. God is saying to all who are dead in sin, awake, thou that sleepeth, and arise from the dead. Ephesians 5:14. That word is eternal life. I'm going backwards here. That word is eternal life, as the word of God, which bade the first man live, still gives us life, as Christ's word, young man, I say unto thee, arise, gave life to the young, to the youth of Nain, so that word, arise from the dead, is life to the soul that receives it. God hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, Colossians 1:13. It is all offered us in his word. If we receive the word, we have the deliverance. I'm not sure if I've skipped here. All right. I guess I left some of them out here. Through faith in him, Christ will make all our imperfect efforts acceptable. Now, reading this so that we don't get the idea that I must come to Christ as a perfect Christian. All right? That's not what he's calling for. He's saying to us, I see what you're like. Don't try to cover it. Don't try to change yourself. Just come to me. I'll do that. Just be willing, all right? Through faith in him, Christ will make, this is, by the way, Faith and Works, page 48, paragraph 3, and page 49, paragraph 1. Through faith in him, Christ will make all our imperfect efforts acceptable to God. The faith we are required to have is not a do-nothing faith, the saving faith that which works by love and purifies the soul. He who will lift up holy hands to God without wrath and doubting will walk intelligently in the ways of God's commandments. As he calls, we respond. He gives us the Spirit to walk in power. If we allow ourselves to doubt and to worry, and if we don't exercise our faith, we will become weak. Our key to having great faith is really to exercise it and stop trying to justify why we don't. Learn and know the Word of God, love God, stop resisting Him, and simply do His will. I heard of this week. This happened in where we used to live. It's about 15 miles away from where we live. It's pretty sad. It got to about 21 below that evening. And what had happened is this husband of hers, who was 86 years old, came in his wheelchair and fell off the ramp and could not get up. So she came out, she heard, or he was calling for her, she heard him and came out, and he said to her, go call 911. She had to walk, she used her walker, right? So then she turned around and lost her balance and fell over. And she could not get up. Now he was coming in, he had a coat and some sweatpants on. All she had on was a nightgown. This happened in the evening. They spent the whole night outside and were found the next morning around 10:30 a.m. And she was dead. Now the reason I bring that up is that if we don't exercise our faith, it will become weak. And there's going to come an opportunity for us to exercise our faith, or there's going to come an emergency for us to exercise our faith. And we're not going to be able to. We are going to be like she was, on the ground, unable to move, and just lay there and die. So we must exercise our faith and do it in a great manner. Large faith. What God says, I will do. We must come to that conclusion. We must stop resisting Him and fighting against Him and rebelling. What we know to be true in the Word of God and in the spirit of prophecy, we must do. We have to be like that centurion. Just say the word and I'll do it. If we could get like that, then it would be said of us, you have great faith. I have not seen so great a faith. No, not in all Israel. And this is what it's going to take in these last days, because we know that things are going to get more and more difficult with the coming of the mark of the beast, with the coming of all of the pressure. We must now begin to exercise that faith. Now, Satan wants us not to exercise our faith. He wants to destroy our faith and keep us in that situation so that when these things happen, we are completely unready and will fail. He wants to keep us in a situation where we're not communing with God, where we're slipping back, backsliding, so that when our name comes up in probation, we will not be ready and will be lost. We must exercise our faith. And it's not difficult. It's a choice. It's just making up the mind. Do I love Jesus enough to choose to do what He says? Or am I going to hold on to my way of doing things? Am I going to trust in my strength, my knowledge, my thoughts? And so, without getting all excited and hyped, yet not being depressed, without any emotions, let's be like the centurion and show this by responding to this question. Do you want to now exercise great faith? If you do, raise your hand. Amen. Praise the Lord. And if you want to commit yourself more fully to the Lord, there's very few of us. Let's come forward and let's have a prayer. We'll kneel down together and let's pray and have God give us what we need, and then we must receive it. Our Father in heaven, the first thing we have to ask is not that you give us great faith, but we have to ask you to forgive us for our lack of faith. We've seen over and over again the love that you have for us, day in and day out. We've seen from the very beginning of your word to the end that God is love. We've seen and experienced your love. We've known and experienced the crucifixion and death of Jesus on the cross, that we might have another probation, that we might have life, that we might have another opportunity to exercise faith in you. Now, Lord, we ask that you would give us this faith. We're here because we want to receive it. There's nothing we can do to merit it. There's nothing we can say. We're helpless. And so we ask that you give us great faith. We know that in asking this, we will have great trials. And so we ask that when these trials come, Lord, please help us to remember. We ask also that you would help us to keep our temples fit and pure so that you will be always with us and that we'll hear you. We thank you for all that you've done for us and what you're going to do. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.